G'day, Mark Griffith here, and welcome to Biodiversity Shorts. Now today, we're on the outskirts of Broome. Now along the coast here, there are heaps and heaps of dinosaur footprints embedded in the sandstone, and we're going to have a look at two different locations today. The first one is here at a place called Dampier. Now you just need to get on the outskirts of town, head towards the port, it's all pretty well signed, and turn right towards Dampier Point in the raceway. And then it's just a few kilometres down this road. Now the most important thing about these footprints that we're going to now is that you need a low tide. The tides are enormous.
This is Dampier Point at high tide, and this is low tide. You're looking at a drop of about 10 metres between high and low tide.
You've got to make sure it's a low tide, which means about below a metre to see these particular footprints. Anyway, let's go.
After a small section of dirt road, you will come to an information centre with more information about all the dinosaur footprints in the area. A short walk down this path past the lighthouse will take you to this piece of concrete, which has three impressions made from a single cast of an original print found closer to the water.
Now the path down to the waterfront, you know, you need to be confident walking over rocks.
With a little luck, searching, and a low enough tide, you should be able to find these 130 million year old footprints. The first scientific study of these prints was done in 1967. Edwin H. Colbert and Duncan Merilles named the dinosaur that made these prints Megalosauropus bremensis, Megalosaur footprints of the Broome area. This dinosaur was a theropod. Theropods had three-toed limbs, were generally carnivorous, and walked on their hind legs. There have been more of these prints found around Entrance Point, further to the southeast. Enough of them to hint that Megalosauropus bremensis moved about in groups. To give you an idea of scale, I've used this Allosaurus animation and scaled it to fit the prints in the rock. Australian Aboriginals have known about these footprints for thousands of years. They explain them by being made by Maralla, the emu man. Maralla was an ancient spirit of the Dreamtime who wandered the coastline here. He was a lawgiver and decided the rules of the country to ensure its well-being. Many related sacred stories are still passed on today. Their meaning is reinforced by the fact that Maralla's body can be seen in the night sky. Dark gas clouds in front of the Milky Way reveal Maralla's emu-like form. There are other prints that the indigenous do not have an explanation for, and perhaps were not even recognised. Early scientific studies failed to notice them as well. More recently, paleontologist Steve Salisbury and his team have been studying and documenting the footprints for many years. This is his research paper, and it is well worth a read. He has shown that there are footprints from many different species of dinosaurs. They are found from here at Roebuck Bay to around 100 kilometres up the Dampier Peninsula. He describes it as a dinosaur Serengeti, with some areas completely churned up by huge numbers of dinosaurs. He has worked to include the tracks as part of the West Kimberley National Heritage Area. This will preserve their cultural value and provide further benefits for tourism. His discoveries include possibly the largest dinosaur tracks in the world at 1.7 metres long. It is these type of footprints that we are going to visit next. To get there, simply drive out of town, then turn right when you get to Crab Creek Road. The road will turn to dirt. It is sandy, corrugated in places, and muddy at times. The prints at this site were made by some of the largest land animals ever to have lived, the largest of which were about 35 metres long and are estimated to have weighed over 65 tonnes. At the large T intersection, continue straight on down the small road. It's a short, rough track, so you may choose to walk down. These giants were herbivores, grazing on the abundant ferns and horsetails. They travelled in groups for protection, and although mostly peaceful, they could protect themselves with their long, whip-like tails. Studies have shown that they swung their tails just like a whip, with the tip moving so fast they could break the sound barrier. The sonic booms would have been heard over hundreds of kilometres. Echoing like enormous thunderclaps.
So right here in front of me, this is a sauropod track, and it's absolutely enormous. It's almost 2 feet wide, and you can see it goes around here, and you can see where the animal would have put his foot down, and the sand has sort of squished itself out a little bit. And then later on, other layers of sand and silt were laid on top, and it hardened and it was preserved. And it's not the only one around here. There's a whole sequence of them. Let me show you.
The multiple tracks provide fairly strong evidence that sauropods travelled in groups. From recent discoveries in Argentina, we do know that sauropods group together to lay their eggs. A single nest would contain around 40 eggs, with hundreds of nest sites in the same area. Each hatchling was about the size of a goose and would fend for themselves, probably growing up in the dense undergrowth. They would no doubt have had a high mortality rate, but once grown, survivors would join the herd. The tracks here can tell us things like how heavy they were, how fast they may have moved, and the way they move. Most importantly, they show how big they were. I'm going to overlay a sauropod model, and again, I will scale it to fit the footprints. The largest prints here are just under a metre long. Given the larger 1.7 metre prints discovered by Steve and his team, and you would have a sauropod almost twice the size of this one. If you don't have access to a four-wheel drive vehicle, it is also possible to visit these footprints as part of a hovercraft tour departing Broome. You may have noticed that I've been making use of a drone to take some of the pretty landscape shots. Drones can take photos which have embedded GPS information. By using overlapping sets of photos and special software, highly detailed and accurate 3D models of the landscape and footprints can be made. I flew the drone over the rocky area near the racecourse and made this 8.6 gigapixel orthographic image generated from the 3D model. It has a detail level of 20 millimeters per pixel. Without even having to set foot on the rocks, it is possible to discover new footprints. Pushing the software, I managed to increase the resolution to 2 millimeters per pixel. Fine enough to spot even smaller objects like this brick or this possible raptor footprint. I am imagining a much smaller version of the popular velociraptor with its large lifted sickle claw. Although I cannot prove that this is a real footprint, such dinosaurs did exist around this time, and new evidence has shown that they had feathers and are the ancestors of modern birds. Further to the east of here is the Broome Bird Observatory, which is on the edge of the richest parts of the Roebuck Bay mudflats. This area is unique and important for many species of migratory shorebirds. 55 different shorebird species, a quarter of the world's total, visit this area. The mudflats are rich in life. All manner of invertebrates provide food for the shorebirds. Mudskippers live here in great numbers and are well worth the messy walk out onto the mudflats. Just keep an eye out for saltwater crocodiles. Today, herons wait patiently to take the odd mudskipper, But 130 million years ago, there were also creatures living in the mud, and evidence of their burrows can be found in the layers of sandstone. It's an interesting thought. Imagine a giant mud skipper being chased across the mud by a hungry dinosaur. There are two more prints that I would like to show you, but I will say again, if you are in this area, you must keep an eye out for saltwater crocodiles. They can definitely run faster than you on this mud.
Now, there are hundreds of sauropod tracks in the area, but this is one of the much rarer theropod tracks and a larger theropod one than the one we saw back at Dampier Point. If you can make it out, it's about this long. There's one toe goes up here, another one, the center toe, is up here, and the other one is down here. And you'd have to imagine it would be an absolutely enormous creature. It's a theropod. No, Tyrannosaurus rex was part of the theropod group. It may well have been one of these.
On further study, it could not have been the ever-popular T-Rex because they simply did not exist until another 70 million years later. It may have been one of his relatives, a megalosaurid, an allosaurus. Even the popular Spinosaurus did exist during the early Cretaceous period, 130 million years ago. I'd like to imagine an ambush predator, like the Spinosaurus, waiting patiently under the water for a sauropod to come and take a drink. And just like a crocodile with a kangaroo would grab it by the head and pull it under, drowning it. With the death blow dealt, it could later emerge from the water and consume the carcass at its leisure.
Thank you for watching, and I hope you've enjoyed this slightly different episode. I'm going to do a little bit of a sketch so you can get an idea of how big this creature might have been. And I'll catch you next time.
Hummingbirds first evolved 42 million years ago, somewhere in Europe. 22 million years ago, they reached South America.
Hello, how are you?